Thank you, and welcome. It's great to be here. It's the first United Goalkeeping Alliance session with the topic being our five elements of goalkeeper's development. And tonight we're lucky to have Tony Elliott and Ryan Godda Thompson, two great friends of mine, and I'm blessed to be working closely with them. A little history on the two of them. Ryan is the current goalkeeper coach for Austin Bold FC. He is the former Jamaican international who has a Gold Cup victory over the United States, a 2-1 victory in 2015. I'll always remember that, Ryan. I have to always say that. And also a quick note about Ryan. He was the first Jamaican player to ever play in the UEFA Champions League. So pretty cool accomplishment there. The owner of RTG Academy in Tampa, Florida. He is also a USSF National A senior license holder. So congrats on that, Ryan. I know that's quite an accomplishment. Good to have you.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you.
And we also have Tony Elliott here. Tony Elliott is the Birmingham FC Women's First Team Goalkeeper Coach. He has his UEFA B license and his UEFA Goalkeeping A license. He's the author of A Modern Approach to Goalkeeping. He's the former international English international futsal goalkeeper coach, as well as the goalkeeper coach to the FA England Deafblind football squad. Ladies and gentlemen, we have Tony Elliott. Tony, how are you?
Good evening, guys. Great to see you. We're a little ahead of time, 5 hours in front, Eastern time here, I guess, in the UK. But been a long day, but great to see everybody. Lovely to see such big numbers this evening joining us, or this afternoon in your time. So yeah. Glad to be here. Looking forward to tonight.
Tony's very busy preparing for his big match against Arsenal on Sunday. Good luck to you there, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, let's go. Tony, you start us off if you could. We're going to basically, guys, go over a quick minute overview of what you had looked at in the coaches panel discussion. We're then going to get into a quick dialogue regarding the five elements, and then we're going to get into a breakout room where you're going to work with one of our United Goalkeeping Alliance coaches, and then we'll come back, speak to the group about your findings in your group discussion, and then we will conclude and wrap up. Whole thing should take us around 45 to 60 minutes. Appreciate your attention for that, and we'll get started now. Tony, right ahead, sir.
Sam, I think we got one or two in the waiting room, so if you want to let them in, that'll be good. And then if you can pop it over to me, I can share my screen.
All yours, mate.
Right, brilliant. Okay. Okay, guys, well, hopefully everyone can see my screen. Okay, can everybody see that? If you can't, just let Eric or Sam know. Okay, so great to see you. Basically, we're going to talk about the five elements of goalkeeping development. So what does it look like in terms of how we develop you as a goalkeeper? Okay, so what we've created, guys, we've created a way of working with you, what we call holistically. So there's not just one way in which we must think about developing you as a goalkeeper. There's lots of different ways. So we're going to look at five different ways in which we can help you. In other words, coaches can help you develop. It's a model that we can use across many different platforms. So we're going to look at the technical side. We're going to look at the tactical side, the physical side, the psychological side, and the social side. And if you look at the image there on the left of your screen, all five interconnect. Yeah, there's probably not one that's more important than the other. In certain situations, one may be a little bit more dominant than the other, but they're all as important as each other in terms of your development. Okay? So, again, when I show you a screen that's got text on it, guys, I'm not going to read it out word for word. But as I'm talking, it might be an idea that you try and pick up some of that text and digest that and take that on board and read through it yourselves. Okay? So, what are the characteristics of the goalkeeper in the modern game? So when we look at the technical side, we look at your technical ability. When we talk about the tactical side of the game, we look at how aware you are. Do you understand the game and your role within it? Do you have the physical capability to be a goalkeeper? So what does it take physically to be a goalkeeper? Depending on what age you are and as you develop, what do you need to build and to develop on and become stronger at to make you a physically capable goalkeeper? Okay. We also look at the psychological balance. A big percentage of how we prepare now and what we do as goalkeepers is about how we control the mind and how we work with the mind in terms of your development. So psychological balance is important. And finally, we look at the social connection between you, your coaches, your teammates, and so on and so forth. And what we look to do is try and develop you holistically. So to look at all of those five elements, each goalkeeper's individual. One may need more development in a certain aspect than the others, but we try and use all of them to develop you to make you a better goalkeeper. Okay? What are some of the challenges then, okay, that face the goalkeeper in the modern game? Okay, and again, I'm not going to read through all of these. And if you notice, guys, I've colour-coded the five elements. So technical is red, tactical orange, physical yellow, psychological green, social blue. Okay, what I've tried to do with these challenges, guys, is look at where I think, where I consider, and you may look at them differently, where these challenges would fit on that five element of development wheel. Yeah, in essence. Okay. So for instance, tactically, yeah, which is the orange colour, we might look at your support and starting positions. So wherever the ball is on the field, what's your position in relation to the ball? Now that may change and be determined by the opposition.
You turn the TV off.
Determined by what situation is in the game, whether your team's got the ball or you haven't got the ball. But they all link and correspond with an element of development, okay? When we look at, on the left-hand side, you can look at the goalkeeper can cover up to 6 kilometres or 4 miles in a game. And we look at that in a physical sense. So the physical demand on the goalkeeper now is changing. So that's why I've put it in yellow and so on and so forth, okay? So those are just some of the challenges that the goalkeeper faces in the modern game as we move forward, and it will evolve and develop further. Okay, so Ryan, I'm going to hand over to you, my friend. I'm going to put the first element on. Okay, so I know you're going to touch on one of those aspects in the technical element. Over to you, my friend.
Okay, thank you, man, for joining us. Tony, I wanted you to open the floor for everyone instead of giving an answer. I'm going to take a volunteer, all right? So let's narrow our lens a little bit more in terms of technical ability and focus on handling or diving. Can anyone tell me some of those, present some of those techniques and why they are important?
Well, for me, I think handling and diving is probably the most important technique because it's not most of the game, but pretty much the job of a goalkeeper is to save shots and dive and stuff like that. And handling comes, it's really important because there's a lot of times where I, like, didn't have good handling and I just let the ball go. They get an easy rebound. And if you have good handling, then that you can prevent that.
Absolutely. What's your name again?
Amir.
Amir, brilliant. So let me ask you one more question, Amir. What are the two roles of goalkeeper? I'm going to first talk about angling. Making save and keeping the ball at the back of the net. What's the second one?
Command your team.
Well, let's move it forward a little bit. You talk. You're also the first attacker. So as you mentioned earlier, you know, if you have the ability to hold the ball, then you can do the second job, right? So great job, well done, Tony. Let's move on to
So Ryan, can I just basically, guys, fantastic, love that, Amir. So what we've done, you guys looking in, the coaches are aware of this, but we're not going to go into detail. But with the five elements, guys, these are the key headings for this aspect. Yeah, for this element. But there is the fine detail, Ryan, as you've just been speaking about, that's some of the fine detail that we may put in for each aspect of those elements. But we're not going to go too deep into that now. So, Ryan, what do you want me to move on to next?
The psychological balance.
Right. Okay, my friend. There we go.
Perfect. And I know this is a big topic, you know, especially for the younger goalkeepers and their parents. And I want us to narrow our lens a little bit more and go onto that bubble dealing with mistakes. Any volunteer, what comes to mind and why it's important that we have the ability to overcome mistakes?
Kyle is ready, I think.
I think it's just having a good mindset, knowing that mistakes are going to make you play better in the long run, you know?
Absolutely. And here's the good news, Amir. We all here as coaches and as players, former players, we have gone through our fair share of making mistakes. And I feel like once we have the mindset that we're a human being, you know, we will overcome and we use those mistakes as an opportunity to learn and grow. I think that's a perfect way and on to the next phase, all right? So, anybody else have anything you want to add to that one?
I think the decision maker is really important because you have to know what you have to do and you have to know, hey, on PK kicks or other things, you got to think that you got to know which way you got to go or where you're going to distribute the ball.
Absolutely. Great job. You know, and I think that we should also, you know, take in consideration, like, dwelling on mistakes, it doesn't help anything, right? It might take away those opportunity of making the next save that's coming up next, the next play. So the sooner we could get rid of mistake out of our mind and focus on the next play, then we can make those big saves, as you just mentioned, saving those PKs and one to follow up for that. Great job.
I personally think that resilience is like very important, because if you're having a bad mindset after letting into a goal, it's only going to get worse. You have to get that out of your mind. You have to just forget about it.
Absolutely. And this is where all of these elements, you know, they intertwine. They all work with each other. All right. Great job. Great feedback.
So again, Ryan. Oh, Natalie, go ahead. Go ahead.
To add on to that, you have to have good emotional control, because if you don't, you might get very angry and lash out, maybe not in a good way. I mean, there is no good way. So you have to make sure you just stay calm for yourself and others.
And why is that important, Natalie?
Because you might hurt somebody, and you also might,
Yeah.
Good job.
Can I ask Natalie a question as well, Ryan?
Absolutely.
So Natalie, if you don't have good emotional control, could it cause you to make mistakes as well?
Yes, it could.
Excellent. So one mistake could become another mistake and another mistake if you don't control your emotions, yeah? Yeah, brilliant. So again, Ryan, like we said in the technical element side of development, we also have some key details that we've discussed and we've talked about when we look at the element of psychological balance. So with some of the information you've just given, guys, here's some real depth of detail for the psychological balance element of development. Now, I'm going to pop back through just so that you're all aware of each of the five, just very quickly. We're not going to talk about them in detail. So this is the technical ability slide with its detail. Now we look at the tactical awareness, and this is quite complex. This is quite a lot of detail goes into this. This is about your understanding of your role within the team, within the game. Yeah. There's the key detail. And again, your coaches are going to help you in the breakout rooms begin to think about and talk about some of these aspects. There's your physical element, yeah, and some of the aspects that you'd need to think about in any given situation. Yeah, there's the key detail. Then Ryan has just gone through the psychological, some of the key aspects with its detail. And finally, the social connection element, yeah? Okay, so there are the key aspects that we'd think about when we're developing our goalkeepers. And there is some of the fine detail that you can attach to those key headings, Does everybody understand that? Is anybody not sure about what we've just shown you there? But it was very quick, I understand, and brief. But time is of the essence. So with each element, there is a number of aspects that have key details that your coaches should need to develop and help you develop through your phases, through your stages of development. Okay? So what we're going to do now, and I'm going to show you a couple of clips before we go into our breakout rooms, okay? And we're going to have five different groups. So what you're going to do, you're going to look at the clips, and then you're going to discuss in your group. Each group will have its own element. So one will be technical, one will be tactical, one will be physical, and so on. When you get into your breakout rooms, your coaches will help you and decide that and know which one you're going into. And what I want you to think about is what have the greatest influences or effects in the outcomes that you're watching, that you see in the clips, okay? So what I want you to think about, these are some ideas that you might start to think about, yeah, when you go into your breakout rooms. When you've watched the clips, here are some of the considerations for you. So in the clips, which aspects from each of your developments, yeah, your elements of developments, which aspects were the most influential in these scenarios? So in each element, we had all those different aspects. But which ones do you think were most important in your element of development? Okay. What helped or hindered the goalkeeper or his teammates during these game scenarios? Yeah. We might not discuss all of them, as I note there. And finally, was there one element, yeah, more important than the others during these game scenarios that you're going to see? Okay. Is everybody clear on that? Now, these are just some ideas of what you need to look at when you watch the clips, what you need to start thinking about, because when you go into your breakout room and you get your element of development, you need to think about that specific element when you've watched these two clips, okay? So we'll come back to this slide, but those are the groups. So if you get group one, you're going to be in the technical element. If you group two, tactical, and so on, okay? We'll come back to that before we go into the breakout rooms. So I'm now going to play the clips for you guys. And I've chosen one of the top goalkeepers from the English Premier League. Okay. Kasper Schmeichel had a very famous father. Peter Schmeichel played for Manchester United a few years ago. Kasper's very similar in his style, in the way he plays. Now I'm going to play the clips. I'll play them a couple of times. Hopefully they'll come across smoothly at your end. If anybody has a problem viewing them, don't worry too much because your coaches should have seen and will have looked at them. Okay? So.
Quick question.
Yes.
So on the subject of Kasper Schmeichel, have you seen the Danish catch that he's done?
Yes.
So I've been trying that. Catch. Yeah. I've been trying that for the past few days and I can't decide which one's better.
Right. Okay.
I'm more comfortable with the traditional technique, but I feel like the Danish catch. It's more secure. Right.
Okay. So now, great question. Love that, Amir. Now, do you mind if we talk about that at the end of the Zoom meeting?
Yeah, that's perfect.
Just remind me, because obviously we've got to get through this and I've got an opinion on it and I'm sure some of the other coaches will. Okay. Awesome. But don't forget, remind me at the end.
Yeah? 1 minute.
Brilliant young man. Okay. Here's your two clips. I'm going to play through them twice. They happen very quick. So again, think of all the five elements. You may be talking about one particular element when you go into your breakout rooms. Here we go. Let me just turn the sound off because we probably don't need the sound on. Okay. Now, did anybody have a problem seeing those clips?
Could you replay one more time, please?
Yeah, they're going to go through. Now, I'm going to give you a little clue, okay? Have a look at the top left-hand corners. Have a look at the scores. Have a look at the times. Hugely important, okay? We're talking about game scenarios, but we're also talking about game management, stages of the game, yeah? Game context. Words I'm using quite big and advanced, but hopefully you'll understand what I'm trying to say when you look at what moments of the game these saves happen. Okay. Everybody happy? Did they come across okay? Did they flow nicely?
Yep.
Okay. Nobody had a problem seeing the clips. Two top saves. Okay. So, there again, just a reminder of some of the things you need to think about. Okay. So, Eric.
Yep. I got it from here.
There's the groups.
All right.
Over to you, my friend.
So, here's how it's going to be broken out. We are going to now divide the participants into five groups. Each group is going to get an element of development. Our five coaches today are Ryan Mattson, who is the goalkeeper director for Florida Premier FC in Tampa Bay. We have Jesse Goldman, who is the goalkeeper coach for the Northeastern Huskies men's soccer team in Boston, Massachusetts. We have Greg Kenny, who is the New York University, I believe it's the men's goalkeeper coach at NYU. Chad Prickett, who's the goalkeeper coach for the Ohio Wesleyan University men's and women's university team, as well as the owner of Columbus Goalkeeper Academy. And Mark Nowak, who is the assistant women's and goalkeeper coach at Fort Hays University. So we are going to then put you into your respective groups. Sam, you can go right ahead and just start assigning. Coaches, 8 minutes. 8 minutes. Thank you, Sam.
No worries, mate. They're all done.
Good. Guys, Ryan, Eric, myself, we'll stay out of it. Sam, you as well, yeah? Are you all aware they just have to click on the join and then they go across, yeah?
Yeah, I'm seeing the participant going way down, which is good.
Yeah. Let me know when we're done.
Yep, it's just coaches here now. It's Sam, Tony. Oops, Sam just went. Now it's the four of us.
Yeah, good. Brilliant. So everybody's gone. Brilliant. Happy, guys?
Yeah. Yeah. Ryan, how about you?
You're on mute, Ryan.
Oh, my God.
Yep.
Right, yeah.
All good, brother. All good.
Happy? Good. Yeah. I think it's gone smoothly. So no problem. I tell you, what about the kid speaking up?
Yeah.
Wow.
That kid's
twice
great.
He answered twice of them. Twice.
Awesome.
Better than the older ones.
Well, yep. Talk about confidence. I'm like, amazing. I'm blown away. What about Amir asking me that question about the bucket catch? Uh-huh. The Danish catch.
The Danish catch.
Yeah. Have you seen it?
Sam.
Yeah. It's like his dad, you know.
Tony, can I jump in real quick? Yeah. Sam, we had someone jump on late.
I've got to sign him to something else now.
Appreciate that.
If I can do it.
We're all in breakout rooms, sir. We're just going to get you into a respective room so you can participate with the group.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So, great. I mean, you know, what a fantastic question from Amir, you know. So, we can talk about that at the end. You know, when we have any questions, he can throw that in there. I'm more than happy to sort of talk about it. Casper's very much like his father. You know, he's totally different, totally radical. Yeah. You know, he's an extreme. So obviously he's using, you know, a technique that suits him. It doesn't suit everybody. And that's what we need to get across, you know.
The question is, though, was it more for fun and giggles? Or because, you know, or it's just, you know, it's actually his thing, you know?
Yeah.
I think a lot of kids saw that.
Damn, everything okay?
Do that in games.
Yeah, well done.
Yeah.
But he will never do it in games. Unless he's Igita, you know?
But Casper did, you know, Casper has. He's used it in games. And that's what, so it's good that, you know, the kids are seeing this, you know?
Yeah.
But this is the thing now. They want to emulate that. They want to copy that. But I think as coaches, we have a duty to give them an understanding of how he's capable of using that technique because he's trained in it, he's practiced it. You know, it suits him, it fits him. You know, and that's vitally important. So I think we can talk about that at the end, can't we?
Thank you, Sam.
So that was there, and then Eric, they had to click join, not me.
Oh, gotcha.
So when we come back in, guys, Eric, you can drive it from there for the next bit.
I'm just gonna go right in order and how I read them, and then have them facilitate their own group, and then after when they're done, I'll then come back to the two of you, Tony, Ryan, and let you guys kind of just wrap up, conclude, kind of ad lib, like you guys kind of do your thing, man. What points do you want to emphasize based on what we're going to talk about? As
Ryan, is there anything from the clips that you want to point out in particular?
Yeah, I think it's important that the moments, you talk about the moments, the second minute and the last minute, that the focus is equally as good from start to finish.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, and then we could talk about when goals normally score, the first 15 minutes to the last 15 minutes, and keepers tend to zone out, you know, are distracted.
Well, what you can also think about, mate, when you talk about it, that's why I wanted that, you know, the context, because, you know, don't forget, they've had a good warm-up, then you go in, you chill out, you settle, and then literally 2 minutes into the game, he's having to produce that first save. Yep. So, you know, we talk about, you know, mentally being prepared, physically having the capability to make the save, you know, the context of the game and game management. And we also talk, you know, one of the big aspects of the technical element is big saves. That's a big save.
Yeah,
it was. Second minute, that's huge. You know,
and
he may not have had anything to do before that. That's his first touch of the ball, probably in the second minute. You know, likewise, the last one, psychologically connected to the game, knows that he's got to make a big save. Physically, both of them, I think, look at the difference in the types of save. The first one, top hand, which has been a big debate recently about near hand, top hand, you know, getting up to those far reaches of the goal. But then the second save, totally unorthodox, like a starfish save, you know?
Yep.
So I think that the physical capability and also having that understanding that it doesn't always have to be textbook, you know? It's just effective and efficient goalkeeping. And that's what I think.
It's just the old school.
Yeah.
The old school mentality.
Yeah.
Any means necessary.
Exactly.
The ball out the net, you know?
So let's just see what they come up with. But I think Sam, Eric, Roy, those would be the key points that we want to sort of drag out of that if that makes sense, you know?
Was there any commentary, Eric, on them clips?
I think so, mate, but I didn't like putting it on because I think one of them's foreign. So
yeah, I remember watching the game and I don't think that the commentators gave him any credit for that first save.
No.
I think they were just like, those sort of saves now are like becoming like the routine ones.
Huge, mate. What I would also do
is look
at the two saves. So the reaction of the opponents after the first save, like how on earth is he saved that?
Mm-hmm.
But for me, more importantly, after the second save, look at the reaction of his teammates.
Mm.
You know, so socially, huge. You know what I mean? Casper's the goalie,
confident.
He's the man.
Confident.
You know?
Yep.
And that's the other thing. So look at how many elements we're touching on now, guys, you know? But that's what I need the keepers and the coaches to understand. So many different ways of looking at one particular situation.
Yeah, even just the sheer commitment. They talk about the physical partner aspect. He was willing to take hit anywhere, anyhow. We talk about robustness and all of that, you know?
Yeah. Exactly.
So,
and you have a keeper who stays in his line, don't you, really, for that second one?
Yeah.
To have the confidence at the last minute of the game to come and make a save like that and pull it off.
Yeah.
So, it says something about him as well, especially being 1-0 up as well.
Yeah. X back with us. How long we got?
Yeah, we're good. Let's get him back in. I was trying
go
to...
Go ahead then.
Yeah, go right ahead, Sam. Just start bringing them all back.
Yeah.
What's
just got the boot out of there for some reason. Not sure what happened there.
Do you want to watch the clips again?
Yeah, why not? Let's start with that and then
I think that's what we do. Yeah. So I'll just go through that again. Quick recap of the slides, then the clips, and then we go.
Yeah, and let the kids talk as much as they can.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, let's stay out of their way. Let's let the coaches facilitate their own group, so to speak. And then we'll add our two cents and we'll have a strong ending with us. You know what I mean?
Okay. So I'll go through these three slides, then show the clips, and then it's over to you, Eric.
Perfect.
And then me and you wrap it up, Roy.
Yep. Sounds good, brother.
Okay, brother. Just let me know when we're ready.
Yeah, and Tony, at the end, when after you do your wrap-up, I'm just going to say a few cosmetic items at the end just to let you know.
Cool. Yeah, no problem, mate.
You're supposed to be in the breakout.
Let me know when we're all in, Sam.
Oh, yeah, it should be...
I'm back.
35 altogether, I think. Don't have anyone else.
Yeah, Tony, we're back, brother. You can go right ahead.
We're good?
Yep.
Okay, great. Okay, guys, so listen, hopefully you enjoyed that process. Before we get you guys to start the feedback, and Eric's going to lead that, we're just going to quickly recap on the process and what you've just gone through. So we were looking at the five elements of development, okay, and how we base our development of you guys holistically. We've gone into the breakout groups. I asked you to, or gave you some ideas of what you might start to think about when you were watching the clips. And there was the three sort of ideas that I tried to sort of lead you with, guide you with. And again, you will have come up with probably a lot more than that when you were in your breakout rooms. Okay? Those were our groups. Eric will speak to each individual group and ask each individual group to give us their feedback. It probably won't be many points from each group, maybe just one or two points from each group. But I'm going to show you the clips again so that you all get another chance to see the clips, and then I'll hand you over to Eric. Okay? Okay, Eric, over to you, my friend.
All right, guys, we're going to go in the order that I read your name. So it's going to go Ryan, Jesse, Greg, Chad, Mark. Ryan, I'll start with you.
Am I supposed to talk? Because I thought we picked the leader of the kids, right?
I don't know who your leader is. Like, you're absolutely right. So you turn it over to whoever you like.
All right, leader. I think it was Micah, right, buddy?
Yeah, that's right. All right. So for the first clip, we talked about first how early in the game it was and how important it was to keep the scoreboard at zeros and not give up a goal early. We're also talking about a little bit of the positioning and how he was, like, in the correct position, basically, when based on where the shooter was coming from, where he positioned to. And also thinking about instead of just, you know, being pumped up for the save in that situation, you have to think about the next play or the corner kick. And then for the second save, we're talking about how it was the 90th minute, and they were up 1-0, so they had to make the – I'm pretty sure it was 1-0. I don't really remember the score, but I'm pretty sure they were up. And they had to keep that game for them. So when it went up in the air, Schmeichel did exactly what he was supposed to. He came out getting ready for that save. And as soon as he made the save, he got right on it, and he didn't really get up. He kind of sat there for a little bit, which is good game awareness, showing that he was aware of the time of the game and that they were up and they need to, you know, waste a little bit of time.
Great job, Micah. Very confident. Awesome. Great awesome. Leader, buddy.
Can I ask a question, Eric? Eric, did Ryan's group have which element were they working on?
Technical.
Tactical.
Tactical. Sorry.
Okay. So when the coaches come in, can you let us know what your element is?
All right, we're going to continue. We're going to go with Jesse. Who is now the physical component. Braden,
can you give a favor, sir?
Could you hit mute? Thank you. Nice. Jesse, we're going to turn it over to your group, which was physical development.
Correct. I totally forgot about picking a leader. So I will leave it up to Kayla or Braden. Do you want to take charge?
I could let Kayla do it.
Take over.
For the first part, we talked about what hand we used and what strengths we use to save the ball, and what we need to do the save. Like, we need leg strength, and we should practice running to help us get that kind of push off our leg to get to the ball. And then for the second half, we talked about reactions and how you need to be able to react to the ball properly. So he said that we should like may throw a tennis ball or a smaller ball against the wall to kind of practice our reactions.
Well done, Kayla. Well done. Is there anyone else in Jesse's group that would like to add to that? Jesse, she'd do a good job with that.
Oh, she nailed it.
All right. Good. Good. We're going to continue then. We're going to go to Mr. Greg Kenny's group, who had the psychological element of development. Greg, could you speak to your who your leader is, please?
Yes, I have decided that Marley will be able to articulate the information that we discerned very well. You okay with that, Marley? Marley.
Marley might be on mute. See where Marley is.
Not on mute. Can you hear me now?
There you go. That's much better. Yes.
Okay. Well, we kind of went over the mindset and in the different points of games, what like we need to be thinking. So like in the beginning of the game, like the first one, if he let the goal in, then he wouldn't be like in the right mindset for the rest of the game. But if they left the, but in the last one, if he left the, he let that one in, he like they would had to go, would have had to go into overtime or a shootout, and then he might not be in the right mindset for that.
Nice. I like that. I like that. Greg, is there anyone else? Is there anything else you'd like to add to that?
Well, it was interesting. We kind of did a little bit of a survey at the end, and it was interesting, and I think this is common of many goalkeepers, is they all brought up, oh, if I gave up, if I made a mistake, if I gave up a bad rebound, if I, and it was mostly negative. And what I tried to say is that it's important that you also reward yourself when you make a good save, because it's a, you know, because it's a difficult job. And, you know, we talked about the Schmeichel first one and say, if he made that effort and just got his finger on and it scored, it would still have been a fantastic effort. It would have been, but he still's got 80, he still has 89 minutes left to play. So the fact that he saved it was wonderful, but even if he had not saved it, he still has 89 minutes to be mentally tough and put it behind him. So, So they were great though. Our group was awesome, and Marley actually had a sister chipping in to help, which was speaking in the background.
Even better.
Marley, great job. Good answer. All right, let's turn it over to Mr. Chad Prickett in your group, which was focusing on the social element of development.
Perfect. So, like you said, ours is social, and we broke both saves down, with the one being 2 minutes and 8 seconds in a 0-0 game, then if I can get just one of the guys in my group or one of the guys or gals to talk on that, then I'll have one talk on the other one.
Sure, I can talk on the first one. So on the first one, we kind of talked about, you know, after you make that initial save, we're talking about the connections, we're talking about how, you know, how would you feel after you make that save? What is like, what are you thinking? So for example, you know, I would say, you know, I would probably be like, you know, hey team, you know, why can't, you know, maybe like try, let's get on that save better next time, you know. The whole thing is you really are directing your team, and it is making a huge part of making that big save is directing your team the right way. And, you know, we talked about, you know, the reaction after the initial save. How would you feel?
Who's that speaking there?
I'm Maddie.
Matt, it's Tony here. So can I ask you a question? You know, after that first save, mm-hmm. How do you think it made Casper's teammates feel? How do you think it made his coach feel as well?
Obviously, they probably felt very happy, you know, a huge relief. Because you totally think that would go in. That's like exactly. 9 times out of 10 usually.
Do you think they trust Casper?
Yeah, but you know you can't. Sometimes when you trust a goalie, they let it go. So.
Of course, but they have ultimate faith in him, so they trust him, and it made them feel good. So socially, it connects him to the team, yeah? It makes him an important part of the group, yeah? Well done. Crack on. Go ahead.
Then, Amir, if you want to talk about the second save, when up 1-0 in the 90th minute, you know, communication, being a leader, being an informer, what do you think you would have done after that save or to help prevent it?
So what I would have done after the save, I wouldn't say lash out, but just talk to my defenders, scream at them in a respectful way, not like, you know, to hurt their feelings or anything. Because I realized during that play, it was a cross back post. I always have a man at the back post, and they usually never let anyone get back there. But if that happened, I'd probably get mad at my player. Not mad. Like I said, you know, tell them in a respectful way. You can't let that happen. But we also said that it's really hard to make a save like that with all the pressure, 1-0, 90th minute, and then to pull it off is just amazing, you know.
So how would you have calmed him down? So 90th minute, everyone's like kind of tense. You just make a big save. How do we just like relieve the pressure? What do we say to him? Say, hey, guys, let's calm down. Let's finish this game out.
Well, so one thing I do, smother on the ground. That's like 4 or 5 seconds. Yeah. And then get up. I have 3 bounces, I believe, and 6 seconds. I maybe go 6-7 seconds if I'm, you know, if I really want to waste time.
Can I just jump in and give you a little bit of advice there, Amir? Yeah?
Yeah.
And I want you to think about this and everybody as well. As a goalkeeper, when we communicate, we can sometimes create one of two things. We can either create calmness or we can create chaos. So in that moment, what do you think the team needed after the save?
Oh, they needed to be calm, very calm.
Calmness, excellent. So in that situation, probably nice and relaxed, made the big save, settle the group down, see the game through, 3 points in the bag. Yeah? Does that make sense? There you go, my friend. Okay.
Go ahead, I was going to add a little bit more to that, Tony. I think it's like a, you know, at least for all of us here, like it's like a perfect time to build trust. Because obviously before the play lead up to that, somebody had to make a mistake. And the mere fact, as a goalkeeper, you were there to clean up that mistake. It's your teammates, if you can look at your teammates and like, hey, I got you. You know, because there's going to come a time when you're the one that making a mistake and you're looking behind to see your defender, you know, doing everything humanly possible to clear that ball off the line or make up for your mistake. So every chance you clean up their mistake, you know, you just let them know, hey, I got you. And I promise you, they will make your job a lot easier. So I just wanted to add that 2 cents there.
Awesome.
Thank you. No, I appreciate that, Ryan. Chad, anything else you want to add, or is there anything else that needs to be said for your group?
No, I think Tony hit on it. Like the time in that, those saves, it just needs different, you know, like a save 2 minutes in, we need to say, hey, guys, I need you to wake up a little bit and we need to step this up, all right? Tune in with me. I'm here to go to war. Let's get on the same page. Whereas the second one, Ryan nailed it. Hey, I got your back. Now, let's see it out. Calm it down just a little bit. Let's be safe and smart here. So, perfect.
Awesome.
Eric, have we got time for me just to go back to the clips, just to show them one thing that really reinforces what we've
just said? Can we get physical out of the way, then come back and use it part of your
team? Let's do that. Because then I'll show them, yeah.
Let's push it over to Mark. Mark, you'll be who is your leader? And again, you're discussing the technical abilities.
Absolutely. So we went over the technical ability with these two saves. And our all-star, Natalie, happily volunteered to lead this for us.
So first we talked about how in the first clip, the goalkeeper was in between the ball and the goal. Now, I don't watch a lot of soccer, so I don't know a lot of goalkeepers. But we talked about how he was in between the ball and the goal and how he was in a good ready position, how he was on his toes and just ready to lunge at that ball. We also talked about how he dived for it, that both of the videos both of the clips, the goalkeepers were making very good saves and very big saves. And in the second clip, the goalkeeper didn't look like he was very surprised at the ball being there. And he just attacked it. He knew exactly what was going on. He knew exactly what he had to do. And he just did it.
Awesome job, Natalie. Eli, is there anything you'd like to add there?
Yeah, and I also noticed when the ball was getting, like, played into the top of the box, like, I noticed how, like, he moved his feet to, like, get in position for, like, the shot.
Brilliant. Yeah, two of the bigger things for both of both the clips we talked about, active footwork, right? Mm-hmm. And we also spoke about coming up with the big time saves.
Brilliant.
Nice. Mark, thank you. Appreciate that. Tony, I'll turn it back to you to present the clips again with the conclusion of Brian.
I'm going to try and jump on to the last clip, okay? And I just want to reinforce what we talked about there. And this is more about social connection, the importance of the goalkeeper, and what it means in those moments when you make the big saves. And I just, what I want you to do, I'm going to show you the save. You know, we've touched on the physical side, the save, you know, his dynamism. You know, he showed his fantastic flexibility, and also his understanding of that it doesn't always have to be textbook. It just has to be effective and efficient in the moment, in the way he makes the save. He just used his body to block the ball. But I want you to look at the way his teammates react at the very end. So watch the clip all the way through, the second save. Watch what it means to his friends, his teammates at the end. Sorry, I'll jump. There we go. There's the save. Watch now. And for me, that's 84. Yeah. Big save, big moments. Probably won the team the game. And that's what I'm talking about, trust. About social connection, having the capability to make the save and understand, you know, the situation in the game. But that's what the goalkeeper means to their teammates, okay? And that's what we're trying to get you to think about when we talk about what we're doing tonight. It's not just one element that is important. We can look at all elements across these two saves, and they all play a bit of a part in terms of the way the situation was dealt with and the outcomes, yeah? And that's what I'm trying to get across to you here. Eric, yours.
I'm all good, man. I think you guys did it. I'm going to let Ryan, I'm going to transition it to you and give you 2 minutes to conclude. And then Tony will go back to you for 2 minutes of a conclusion. Yep. And then I'll wrap it up with some fundamental basic stuff just going forward. Ryan, it's all yours.
Yeah, I think just in general, you know, looking at both plays, there's some important things, you know, like a lot of important things happen there. We talk about the psychology, we talk about the social, we talk about all five elements. But I want to narrow it a little bit more and really think about Kasper, the goalkeeper, Kasper, the human. How did Kasper feel in that moment after he made those two unbelievable saves? I can tell you this much, man. You know, he has worked all his life to feel the way you felt in that moment. You're talking about confidence builder. That is the biggest confidence builder right there. You know, just to see all your teammates coming around and patting on the back like, hey, you just saved the day. But of course, you have to satisfy all five elements, weeks in, weeks out, months, days, years, just to produce one of that moment. So we're not gonna say one is more important than the other, but it does feel good as a goalkeeper, as a person, when you're able to help out in crucial moments. And that's what we saw in those clips. A lot of it, again, wasn't orthodox. It was unorthodox, but it was effective and efficient. And I think we got to always have that mindset, any means necessary. We're willing to go above and beyond and not give up on play and just to keep our team in games. And when we can't, we're just human beings. We learn from it and we move on. So I think all of this is just a way of all of us growing. Again, this panel in itself is all of us growing as coaches, as goalkeepers, as humans. And, you know, I'm just glad that I have the ability to share knowledge and collaborate every single one here. So, Eric, thank you very much for having me here. You know, Tony as well.
Thank you, sir. Tony, I'll turn it over to you.
Yeah, so a couple of things. Listen, coaches, I think most importantly, we look at the clips. And I think even the young goalkeepers with tonight have showed fantastic confidence to share their observations and their thoughts and findings from these two clips. But I think what it does give us an understanding, guys, is that in any given moment, it's not just one element, one aspect that we need to focus on, we need to look at. So many different elements and aspects can affect the goalkeeper in any given moment. And to develop them to their fullest potential, we must think about the five elements of development and how we holistically develop our goalkeepers. Goalkeepers, you're never always going to get it right. You're going to mess up. You're going to get it wrong. It will get messy. But don't worry about that. Yeah, being a goalkeeper is probably the toughest role within the team. Bad things are going to happen. Mistakes are going to happen. But try taking them as learning opportunities. Put them behind you. Move on, but then continue to work hard to be the best you can be in every moment that you put the gloves on. And that's what I'd like to finish with tonight.
Can we talk about the
bench,
Cash?
Eric, time.
Amir, go ahead, sir. Ask your question, please.
So like I said earlier, it's interesting to me. Like I said, what do you think about it? Should I do traditional or Danish Cash?
Good question. Who wants to go? Me? Ryan, it's up to you.
let's put it this way, Amir. What are you good at? Which one are you most effective at? Because if you're effective a traditional way, why switch to something that you're not effective at? You know, it's all well and good that there's a lot of trends going on, but not every trend is something that you should pick up. I think you should go and you should try. If it works, it works. If it doesn't work, you know what? Try something else. Stick to what you're good at. You know, focus on your strengths, in other words.
Yeah. Excellent.
That's my 2 cents.
Mine would be then, look, you know, as we talked about, Casper, very similar to his father. You know, if you ever get the chance, you know, go on YouTube and look at some clips of Peter Schmeichel, Casper's dad. Probably one of the greatest goalkeepers ever lived. Fantastic for Manchester United and Denmark. Won many, many trophies and had a hugely successful career. But he made a living out of being different. Yeah, being unorthodox, but being effective. Now, the way he kept goal was probably very different to the way most goalkeepers would work in a technical sense. But you also have to look at his background. He came from a background of handball. It's a sport they play around the world, very, very much played in Denmark. So Peter actually played handball. So some of the traits, the techniques that you see that he used, and obviously Casper has taken on, like the second save you saw this evening, they come from working and playing different sports. So he's adapted those into his game. So like I've said to you, listen, it may fit him. He's trained and practiced at it. He's tried it in training many, many times, and it now works for him at elite level during pressurized situations in games. What I wouldn't suggest is that you try it first and foremost in a game where there's something at stake. Have a go at practicing it. If it works, fantastic. Like Ryan said, if it doesn't, then you leave it and you keep doing what you know is best for you. But I'm not saying for a second, don't try these things. But you must practice it first before you try and then transfer it to a game.
Oh, can you explain it to me in a minute? In 30
Where's
seconds? Maybe Amir can explain it.
Yeah, let's go. Let's see what Amir comes up with. Can you give us an image, a showing of what you see?
In what?
What the technique.
Danish catch.
Yeah, the Danish catch.
My zoom. All right, so I'll just give you, it's pin your arms together like this. And then it's kind of weird because you have to pretty much do this, like at the exact time the ball comes to your chest. So that's the thing I'm not too comfortable with.
Amir, show me that again. Show me that again, because I couldn't see. I can now.
It's like this or like this.
Yeah, so he kind of brings his hands here, doesn't he? Yeah. So what he does, he allows, you know, when we're coaching you as goalkeepers, what do we generally say when you're working with your handling is your first point of contact on the ball? What part of your body?
Your hands.
Your hands. Well, when you watch Casper do that, where what part of his body generally has first contact with the ball?
His body.
His chest. Stomach. Yeah, and then the hands come around and secure the ball at the same time.
So this
Say again?
So this is dealing with a shot that he's fully behind and instead, okay, so it's yeah. All right.
Yeah, but he's also done it when he's diving, Greg. I've seen him do it, not just standing and catching. He's actually done it when he's diving and he's allowed the ball to come into his chest and then cut the hands over the top. I'd love to have a football nearby me to show you properly, but I haven't got one. Yeah. Very unorthodox, but for him it's been effective, but he's very practiced in it. So.
Okay, that's interesting. So he lets it hit his chest, even if he's diving. He uses his chest as a third hand like you would on the ground, but he uses his chest as it.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. Grab it on, it'd be on YouTube, so grab yourself a look if you can find it.
I will.
Cool.
One thing with the catch I also found really good is that I know sometimes with powerful shots and I do this, I usually bend down to, you know, relieve the pressure. Mm-hmm. But with the Danish catch, I feel like it's safer. And most of the time, I really don't have to do that. I think it relieves all the pressure for me.
If it works for you and Mia, then who are we to tell you not to do it more often?
I love it. Well, Amir, I appreciate that question, and I'm going to open up to others. We have about 3 minutes until I want to get us out of here at 6, but we will go over if the questions continue. Let's start it. Who has a question for Tony or Ryan? And do not raise your hand. Just go right ahead and speak, please.
No question. Interesting.
I got a question, if that's all right. So, Ryan, you've played in some big games. One of the things I work on a lot with my goalkeepers is getting them to mark up. If you have somebody, a midfielder or a defender, that's maybe just doing an okay job marking up, what are you saying to get that picked up a little bit?
First and foremost, again, we talk about the message, you know, being a communicator, one, two, being a leader. You know, the defenders, they got to trust the message and the messenger. You know, so if I don't build trust in the beginning, it's going to be very, very hard to go in the game and for them to listen to me. So that process is going on weeks and months before. You know, we're talking about practice sessions. So they actually understand, you know, me as a goalkeeper, and I understand them and what stimulus they respond to. That is very important. Also, another thing that we got to take in consideration, you know, and I got asked this question, I want to say 2 weeks ago. When you're in a stadium and there's 40,000 people, how do you communicate? It's hard. That is very hard because they can't hear you. You can't hear them. No. And this is where we talk about chemistry and understanding and the game before the game. We're building this weeks, months, years before. So, you know, we have that relationship, you know. So that's why relationship is crucial. For example, in this play with Casper, they know if they let the shot out, Casper is going to do everything in his power to keep the ball out of his net. And they trust that he will, you know. So they allow those shots to come from distance versus closer, you know.
Awesome.
Cool. Other questions?
I have a question. I don't know if you can answer it, but a pin player to only being a goalkeeper, what age would you generally do that? And second question, if you have a goalkeeper that's incredibly talented, but the emotional well-being isn't there in terms of being the team leader and building up the players rather than bringing them down with no attitude. Do you correct that, or do you just move the player on to a different position?
Can I answer the first part, Ryan? Is that okay?
Absolutely.
Eric, you and Ryan can jump in. So I can give you an idea of the way we look at it in the UK. You know, I've worked at, you know, academies, Liverpool, Man City, and many other different sort of clubs in terms of working through the phases. Foundation phase, which is the young end, youth phase, professional phase. Generally, what I'd like to see is that young players have an opportunity to try different positions. So we probably wouldn't pigeonhole a goalkeeper yet until they're 11, 12 years old over here. We'd give them an opportunity to play different positions. Players can play where they want. And ultimately, by that age, we'd like to think that they've found their position. Now, that's not to say at 7, 8, 9 years old, you might find a diamond that wants to be a goalkeeper, that fits the profile, that loves being in there and getting their hands dirty and diving at feet and making big saves. that's going to happen. I started at the age of 7 as a goalkeeper and never looked back. But from my point of view, the more chance they get to play the different positions, they're also going to have a broader, more rounded understanding of the game as a whole in terms of how players play in different positions, what attackers might be thinking when they bear down on goal, you know, how people defend in certain situations. So it just builds their knowledge up of the game in general. Then they can specialise as they get a little bit older. That's generally the way we'd like to do it here in the UK. It may be different in the US, I don't know. But that's how we try to do it here. Part two, Ryan or Eric, you can go.
Actually, I want to, Ryan, I want you to expand because I know your story and I hope you're going to say it, but I'll let you talk.
Yes. So it's hard for me to tell you, okay, they should specialize at a younger age or older age. For me, I started being a goalkeeper at age 14, so it was a little bit later. So now to the second part of your question now about do they play other role? Yes. For me, I was an outfield player, one. And then I also encouraged multiple sports. I was a sprinter. I was a cricketer. I was a wicket keeper. I did a little bit of cheerleading. So in that same process, I'm training different muscles. You know, cheerleading, I was very flexible. You know, cricket, I talk about a small ball, work on my reflexes and my hand-eye coordination. You know, and then track and field, being really explosive, coming off my line. And I think when I got introduced at 14 as a goalkeeper, it was so much easier to accelerate certain teaching points because everything I'd already had. So I encourage multi-sports, one. Two, you know, don't pigeonhole yourself because one, you know, you don't know what you're really good at until you try it, you know. And the second part, the third part of the question about being a leader, I think being a leader, it's a journey. You know, I think that's a journey, honestly. And I think if the minute you decide that you're going to be a goalkeeper, you're going to figure out if this is for you or not. You're going to figure out if you're a leader or not. And if you're not, you're going to learn real quick how to be a leader, you know, because you will get punished. And when you get punished, it's not a good feeling. And if you want to continue that journey, you will evolve, you know. So I think everything is a process and there is no yes or no answer. We just got to go through the process of finding out and see what works for you and what doesn't work.
Awesome.
Did that answer your question? Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome. Well, guys, with that, if you could just give me 2 minutes to round everything out, and we'll get you out of here. First and foremost, can we all give a golfing clap to Mr. Ryan Thompson and Mr. Tony Elliott, please?
I have one more question.
Ah, Tyler, you go right ahead, sir. I'll go right ahead, please.
If there was one thing you could tell yourself when you were an 11-year-old, what would it be to improve on?
Oof. Do I say that one, Tony?
Yeah, I mean, listen, for me, it was to probably listen more because I was very single-minded and I kind of patterned myself to believe in me and trust myself. But I probably didn't listen enough and take enough information on board, which might have helped me a little bit later in life. And one thing I've learned now as a coach is to take that learning into the way I coach now. And that's to listen a lot more, not to continually give information to drive. Listen to people, listen to their opinions, listen to their thoughts and feelings. And I probably wish I'd have done a little bit more of that when I was a headstrong youngster. Yeah, because there was one direction I was going. That was the pro game. That's where I ended up, 14 years a pro. But, you know, at the end of the day, I think if I'd have probably just took that advice a little bit earlier, I might have learned quite a lot more. So listen to good coaches. That's key for you goalkeepers because they've got a lot to share with you.
Cool. Ryan? Yeah,
and I think one for me is to stress less. At the end of the day, everything will be all right, man. At the end of the day, it's always all right as long as you give your best. Things always play the way it is. And if it doesn't, then why stress? You know, you control what you can control, you know, and things will fall in place, man. So as a 11-year-old, 12-year-old, even as an adult, why stress? You know, your great Bob Marley thing, every little thing is going to be all right. It's always all right, my friend. You know, so, you know, and I think as goalkeeper, man, you got to laugh at your mistakes, bro. You got to laugh at it, move on quick, because everything will be all right. So, stress less.
Ryan, you said it, but we were all thinking it, man. I love how you kicked in with that verse. Guys, again, Ryan, Tony, this means so much to me that you're a part of this, in addition to the coaches that we had leading our goalkeeper breakout rooms. Thank you very much. What we're going to be doing going forward, if you did not receive an email with the notebook and the 2021 calendar, parents, let me know, all right? Send an email to the United Goalkeeping Alliance at yahoo.com and send any inquiries, any questions you have. We are going to be doing this next week. And of the five elements of development, we're going to focus on two of them. We're going to focus on the tactical and the technical. And with those two subjects, we are going to be working with Coach Rick Stanton. Coach Rick is at George Washington University with the women's team. He's a goalkeeper coach there. He's had stinks with the professional women's game as well. And I know he's been the head coach at Seton Hall in addition to others. So we're very blessed to have Rick in addition to Mark Litton. Coach Mark is a professional indoor goalkeeper coach currently, and he was also a United States futsal national team goalkeeper coach in his heyday. So we have two amazing guests next week. And the following week, the 2 weeks from now, we'll discuss the other three elements of development, psychological, physical, and social. And we'll have Dr. Bill Steffen from there, as well as Mr. Jesse Goldman, who's on the call tonight, in addition to Ryan Defebaugh, who is owns the MBS Consulting, which is basically a consulting firm for student athletes. So we're going to get some interesting perspectives there. We are also going to be conducting one meeting with everybody in about 2 or 3 weeks for feedback and for an understanding as to what's happening in 2021 and how this is going to proceed. So more to come. You'll also get a survey from us on Monday. If you could quickly take that survey, it would be grateful for us because you are our client. And I can't stress that enough. We have 30 amazing coaches involved in this project, and we all want our goalkeepers to improve. We are going to do whatever it takes to make sure you get to that next level of development in this setting. So we're really looking forward to this challenge. Everybody, thank you for participation again tonight. And if you have any individual questions, you can email that address that I mentioned earlier anytime, which is United Goalkeeping Alliance at yahoo.com.